now shift focus to speaking with Capri Global. We wanted to chat with them and figure out about the funding cost environment amid this tight liquidity situation. Also get it, get an update on the capital raising plans that the company may have, and overall get a sense of their business outlook going into FY20. And of course, can the upcoming event, the big budget, be a boost for the SME sector or not? Rajesh Sharma, the MD at Capri Global, joins in on the show. Rajesh, hi, good morning. Good to have you in our studios. Help us understand first, what is going on with the environment? Because you would have a clear pulse on what really is the situation on ground. How tight is the funding environment and liquidity in the system?
So liquidity is tight in the sense the lenders are little cautious because of few defaults and few concerns on the NBFC's asset liability mismatch. While the asset quality has not deteriorated, but asset liability mismatch is something which is causing concern to the lenders. So the sanctions are taking a little longer time. The cost of fund have gone up between companies to companies from 50 basis to 100 basis. And definitely liquidity is tight. So everybody is slow down their disbursements. And some of the company is not doing at all. So I think there is a slowdown because of availability of funds. Last couple of months, it has started improving with the public sector bank recapitalization and all. But I think we are hoping that government will do something in terms of making funds available faster and easily available.
Does the government have those tools to try and bolster confidence between MSME lending? And can the budget be that one event where we could hear some sort of moves? What are you expecting?
I understand that government is also worried, and they have collected a lot of suggestions where bankers have sent them, whether lending to MSME and affordable housing can be classified as a priority sector lending, and whether lower rated companies can be given the funding. So there are a lot of suggestions have been compiled with. We believe that some action positive to take care of the sector, because NBFC is lending to those customers where bankers are not lending. So shadow banking and NBFC lending is working as a complementary to the banking system. Slowdown on this can affect the economy directly. So I'm sure there will be some adequate measures will be taken, and soon we'll see the normalcy is back to the sector.
Right. You know, when we just talk about the first point that you highlighted, which is about the confidence, the lack of confidence in various companies and disbursements being completely stopped. You know, how does that impact the balance sheet of any company? One side, they are not getting any liabilities. Secondly, they are not having asset growth because of disbursements. So they are forced to sell down their assets.
I think this, they will sell down the portfolio to garner the liquidity to maintain the repayment on time. And how it will affect is their OPEX in the absence of disbursement, or in the lack of full disbursement, partial capacity utilization of their team. I think that will increase their operating cost, and that will affect on the profitability for sure.
So let's just talk about who benefits from this. You think larger NBFC players, companies which have great capital or ability to raise capital faster, will actually benefit in this environment when things get better?
I think benefiting only those companies who are lending to those sectors. So it depends on which sector which company is lending. Now larger companies, if they are focusing on a former salaried class of customer, but availability of funds to the problem for everybody. Like this mutual fund withdrawing from actively lending have affected triple N, double A plus companies, because mutual fund used to lend only those companies.
Okay, let's come to your business now, Capri Global. As I understand, in March, your board approved raising about 1,000 crore rupees via QIP and an issue of 2 crore equity shares via rights as well. If you could help us understand what is the progress in both the QIP as well as the rights, and what is the timeline?
So as far as capital is concerned, we are well capitalized. As of now, we are about 34% capital adequacy ratio. So from the requirement perspective, there is no immediate need, but this is enabling resolution, because the better liquidity will help the company in the tough time. So we have so far not started the process. We kept enabling resolution. When the overall sentiment improve, we'll meet the investor, and that time we will take the call.
Right. So just when we talk about your business, can you just tell us about the portfolio of lending that you have? Whom do you lend more? I think MSME is one of your key clients. What's the activity over there? Because, you know, we spoke to Dabur today. We've been speaking to a lot of companies about slowdown. In such slowdown, MSMEs are facing more slowdown?
So as far as the customer demand is concerned, that is intact. What has slowed down is the availability of funds. So customers are intact. The market of demand of the money is intact. Our key growth driver of the company is lending to MSME customers who are underbanked and underserved, who do not have an income proof or who do not have an adequate income proof to demonstrate their business profile. So just to make it more relatable, like a guy who is running a bike repairing shop in a small town of Vadodara, or a guy who is running the small temporary food setup in some place, when they want money for growth, the company like us understand them in the land. They are not able to access those requirements from the formal banking system.
Right. If I look at your funding, can you just tell us about your borrowing mix? Banks are primarily your borrowers, and that is helping you to get funds even in such an environment?
So we have about 20 lenders in mix of private PSU and foreign banks, and we are getting repeat funding from them. Our borrowing profile is, fortunately, we do not have any commercial paper or NCD. Agent date, 100% borrowing is long term and from the banks.
Okay. Also, let me understand, you know, you're targeting a good 6,050 crore rupees of assets under management in FY20. Is it achievable?
Yes, it is achievable, because with a low base of 4,100 crore, still we can achieve a 50% growth. And we believe that we are still getting the money because our ticket size is granular, lending is secured. Average ticket size about 15 lakh, wealth collateralized by the real estate. Performance of the NPAs is good. We have less than 0.63 of net NPA. So with this kind of quality, I think lenders are comfortable. And while it is taking longer time, while the cost of fund have gone up, but availability of funds is available to us.
Right. So when we just look at the availability of funds and the sort of demand that you're having, looking at all of that, what do you think the company can grow in the next 2-3 years? 20%, 30%? How will you target any growth number that you are looking at for?
So we are targeting in next 4 to 5 years a balance sheet size about 25,000 crore. That is the aim we have set up internally, and that is the guidance we have given on our annual presentation also. We believe if we continue to grow 40-50%, this can be achievable. And in a country like us, where the MSME gap is more than 16 lakh crore, I think many more companies like us are required to address that gap.
Okay. So, just wanted to understand a little bit about asset quality, because as I see, your GNPA ratios are maintained, but absolute GNPAs have also risen by FY20. Do you see a risk of rising NPAs because of this concentration within MSMEs?
So our gross NPA have gone up by only 5 basis points.
Sure.
So I think this 5-10 basis will be here and there. But I don't think the asset quality in MSME sector in particular is going to be challenging, because these guys are small businesses. When they make capital available to them, they do quite well. Their cost is in control.
Which segment do you think is challenging and most risky?
I think ticket size of more than 2 crore to 10 crore is more risky. While we deal with the ticket size of 5 to 50 lakh is quite safe. If we see the TransUnion latest CIBIL report, last 4 quarter they issue the report on quarterly basis. Every quarter they are saying the lowest NPA is in the ticket size of 5 to 50 lakh rupees secured lending.
Right, so that is the space where if there would be any asset quality issue, the 2 to 10 crore would be the space where if there is any issue, the asset quality could...
We believe that sector is under the stress. The SME high ticket lending is under stress for various reasons.
Right, so a lot of portfolios are on the sale. A lot of companies are looking to sell down assets. Are you bidding for them? Are you looking to, you know, get this number of 25,000 crore faster if you know you're looking?
No, I believe we will do organically by building our own portfolio with our team. Currently, we are operating through about 84 branches, and we intend to make the branch network to go up to 235 in the next 4 to 5 years. So we believe it is a local understanding business, which we do it well. We want to do it internally with our team only.
Right. So last year for NBFCs in terms of sector has not been that great. A lot of issues have popped up. You think FY20 will also be a challenging year for the sector?
I think in another couple of months, it should settle down and availability of funds should be adequately made available to those companies which are doing well. I feel sentiments will improve, the trust deficit will go away, and I feel that 2019-20 will be a better year for all of us.
Right. Thank you so much, sir, for taking our time for us. Always good to get perspective from you. That was a word coming in from Rajesh Sharma of Capri Global, who was saying that FY20 can be a good year for the NBFC space, but they are comfortable with their capital situation at this point. On that note, we're taking a break. Coming back.